Like Louis Armstrong, play the trumpet, I'll hit that bong and break you off something soon. I got to get my props. Cops, come and try to snatch my crop.
Welcome to the Windy Hill Windsock. With me, The Solution, and joining me today is the correspondent.
Hello, buddy.
How are you, mate?
Oh, yeah, pretty shit. Whatever. Next.
I understand you had a successful AGM today at the...
Yeah, no coup. There was no overthrowing now. Yes, very successful afternoon down at the local bolo.
So you're now president. Is this right?
Officially, as opposed to unofficial, now official.
Okay, so beer's going to be discounted. That's all I need to know.
Mate, as
for Windsock fans.
Nepotism is alive and well across the inner north of Melbourne. So to answer, yes.
I'll give you the tip. It's alive and well anywhere. With us is the architect.
Hey, mate, how are you going?
Good, mate. How are you?
Oh, living the dream, buddy.
What's the Bombers jumper in the background, by the way? I've never asked you.
That is the famous year, or the infamous year, all the players signed it. So it's just that year.
So hang on, 2016, 2012?
2012. Oh, Jesus. Has it been swabbed for supplements?
No, mate, no. No, it's hidden safely behind glass. It can stay there.
All right, that's good. And with us is... Jez, who has made it safely back from Sleepy Hollow. How was it? Did you have fun?
Look, I did. The company was great. It was fun to go on a little road trip. The football was pure diarrhea, but the rest of it was great.
Did you do the Geelong thing and go and take some ice down near the local 7-Eleven?
Well, for me, the Geelong thing is going to Ripper Roasts before the game, which is right across the road, and it was closed, and it was just devastating. We might as well turned around and gone home right then.
What do you mean closed? What's going on?
It was just closed. Like, the shop was there, but the lights were off.
It's Saturday night in G-Town.
I know.
Quite a similar experience, not far from you, architect, is Hannah's Kebabs in Sydney Road. Do you know it?
I think I do, actually.
A truck. And Friday night, I journey out to Coburg, put on my bulletproof vest. It's a little bit hairy, a bit sketchy. The caravan is closed, and I'm literally swearing at them, and then I get there, and there's a sign. We have lost somebody, so we're not opening this weekend. I felt so fucking bad. But anyway, all right, we've sort of... circumvented the real issue. That was putrid. I was literally getting a sort of a pain above my right eye watching that game. It was tough viewing. And, you know, I must admit, there was a bit of raging going on social media. And I get a little bit annoyed with the patronising. Come on, Essendon fans, calm down. Well, we get the big picture. We know that there's a Essendon revolution happening, and it's a longer term 3-4 year plan. We get all of that, but what we at least expect is the team to be competitive, and that was pathetic from just a effort perspective. That was shit ass and unacceptable. Who wants to start? No one? Jess, you were there.
Yeah, well, look, I was there, and I have watched the replay today as well.
Jesus Christ.
So,
mate, it's something you are mentally ill.
Because I just wanted to see from a different angle, like, what happened. Because at the ground, it was boys against men, and it was like we were just sort of absolutely bullied physically. Around the ball and off the ball in every contest. And I just wanted to look at it again and just see if my eyes were deceiving me. But no, they weren't. We were just torched physically.
Mate, I don't know why you just didn't call me. I would have saved you 2 hours watching the replay. I would have given you the answer.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, no, put that one away. It was a shocker. It was just terrible. It was terrible. There were no redeeming features, I don't think. Geelong has... I mean, I'm angry with myself. I'm not angry with the players, not angry with the club, angry with myself, because I got caught up in the hope and the expectation that this might be the day we break the hoodoo, we beat Geelong, you know, down at the Cattery, and it would be the good story. All these Essendon supporters getting their little single seats scattered all over the place, and we'd all be down there for a famous win. And not just very much not to be, and I'm just... Yeah, I was cross with myself for getting caught up in all that. I should know now.
Not only caught up in the game, like, without being melodramatic, Architect, I'll throw this at you. Aren't we better off just letting the 2023 finals run kind of dream? Let's just throw that out the window. But the team isn't ready. That was a finals. That was like playing a final. And that's what would happen if we played the first final with the current team as it is. Granted, we've got some important players out, in particular Draper. But aren't we better off just going back to plan A at the start of the year, which is let's play kids. Let's play Brian instead of Phillips. Let's play Davey. Let's play young players, and let's just build for the next couple of years, because this team as it stands isn't good enough to play against the real heat.
I think I agree with you on that one. I think this was the wake-up call of you're not ready yet. You're building, but you're not ready yet. Because, I think you're absolutely right. If we come up against Geelong in the first round of the finals, if we were to kind of scrape over the line, we're going to have another one of those incidents where the hopes are high. My gut feel is we'd walk away with an absolute thrashing. So yeah, I'd prefer not to make it. And as you say, solution is to play the kids, give them a real chance to kind of, see that level of intensity that they need to play at, and just learn from it.
Correspondent, a lot was made of the ground before, and the way we play Cardinia Park. To me, it's a little bit like Cardinia Park's a bit like Punt Road. There is only one way, the corridor, and you can try and take the side streets, you can try and take the back streets, you're going to end up stuck in the fucking traffic.
Well, Swan Street.
Well, it doesn't matter whether you try and go down Swan, try and...
Lennox Bridge, whatever.
Yeah, church, whatever it is, you're fucked if you're stuck in Punt Road, you're fucked. There's no way.
I think you guys, I think we've got to take a breath, right? We've been competitive in every game this season, bar, you know, one or two, which were very much explainable. Yeah, last night was everything that could have gone wrong from a player point of view went wrong. Geelong were on. So I just think you move on. We've been very competitive against Collingwood, Port Adelaide, Melbourne, Brisbane. This is one game, right? That's going to happen. And for those of us who are old enough to remember 1992, we got pantsed very late in that season by Hawthorn by, I don't know, 100 and a lot. And a year later, we win a premiership. I'm not saying that's on the cards, but, yeah, you take learnings from it. But last night was just nothing went right at all.
Certainly didn't.
Did you just say the L word?
What? Huh?
Did you just say the L word?
I thought I heard it.
Yeah.
Our learnings. Anyway, look, I actually caught up on a couple of episodes of Ted Lasso, I think, during the second and third quarter. So.
Yeah, I'm still staggered that Jez watched the replay. That to me, did you at least fast forward, have it on like times two?
Did you have it on like the KO where it has the highlights? It would have jumped through about 2 hours.
Yeah, okay.
No, I just chipped away and endured the lot.
But to be fair, like, I mean, my point is that, like, you know, no one played even an average game.
So this leads me to the awards. So, Jez, you're going to do it. And we've said, do we need the full hour today? Yes, we do, because we've got a Henneman Award to deliver. And there are multiple nominations, I would suggest. But you can start with the herd if you like. Maybe the tradition is to start with the herd and move to the Hederman. But what have you got?
I've got 1, 2, 3, 4 names for the herd. What I want to preface it by...
Four.
Yeah, four.
Is one of the three of them the umpires?
What I didn't like about the game was we were physically bullied early, right? I get that. But there seemed to be a complete unwillingness, a lack of willingness to stand up and push back, to actually kick back against some of the physical pressure and get in their face. But I think there were some exceptions that I think Laverty tried his guts out and was not put off by the physical pressure. I think he had a real red-hot go. I know he only played three quarters, but because he got subbed off, but I think he's in the conversation.
Firstly, it's very hard to stand up and push back when you're on all fours. That's what I'll say, number one. But number two, Laverty's in my shortlist for Hennemans.
He was
one of the panickers.
Can we get back to your all fours? I didn't realise the all fours thing makes that's interesting talks.
Well, that's what happened to us. We got reamed. But you seriously putting Laverty in the herd conversation?
Totally.
I thought he got some of the football. Mind you, the ball was in defence all the time.
Yeah.
But he was, as I said, one of the chief offenders for just throwing it on his boot indiscriminately and causing turnovers.
Look, my award, mate. It's my award, mate. And
I was about to say, it's Jess's award, mate. Pipe down.
Architect, what are your thoughts?
I don't know. I thought he played all right as well. I'm with Jez on this one. He was running at over 80% disposal efficiency, so he wasn't coughing it up that much compared to a lot of other players running around.
I also thought Hobbs was great. When I say great, I don't mean great. I mean he actually showed some spunk.
It's all relative.
Correct. He showed some spunk and he wasn't off put by the pressure and he gave as good as he got. It's just that he was flying solo in there, in the middle. So I thought he was in the conversation. Now,
I agree.
I thought Zerky played well. He got kicked four or five goals kicked on him, okay, which is fair enough, but he did a whole lot better than last time on Hawkins. But he also played off Hawkins a bit and was intercepting. And so many of our players just seemed, not timid is the wrong word, but they weren't taking the game on, and he was. He took our most number of marks. He played with his usual desperation, and I think he's in the conversation. I didn't notice does. Sorry, go on, mate.
Oh, sorry. I think the problem he had, and I don't know if you're going to mention McGrath, he's one of my players I thought tried his guts out. But the problem that all these guys had, and maybe this is where I need to give Laverty a pass, partly possibly because of the narrow ground, there was just no spread. So the guys in defence were just like standing there and they're looking up and there's a wall of Cats players inevitably in the corridor, which is all it is, Cardinia Park, one big corridor, and they just had no one to kick to.
Was that on the forward line then from coming too far up the ground? Because it did look like we were flooding defence and Geelong were just sitting back outside the 50.
I don't think it mattered. It was, as Solution said, like you looked up and because the ground's 10, 15 metres narrower, it's like they got nowhere to go.
It's like there's all these little tributaries that lead to the one river and all the Cats players did was sit there in the river and just wait for the ball to come. It doesn't matter which direction you try and go. Again, it's like the cunt road analogy. But sorry, Jess, cut you in your tracks there.
No, but I thought BZT was okay. Now, I didn't notice Duz on the night, but when I watched the replay, I thought Duz was another one who actually had a crack and got in their faces and actually pushed back against some of the physical pressure. He didn't play four quarters, but I thought what he did was good. They're the four names. There's another two names that get half a pass. I thought Zach Merritt he obviously got beaten, or he got tagged very well. He got tagged very, very effectively, but he didn't stop trying. He did his best, and Nick Bryan toiled hard. It was good to see him get a mark and kick a goal at the end. He's no Sam Draper, okay? He's not our number one ruckman. But he didn't flinch last night. He had a go, and I thought he was worthy of half a mention. But I've got nothing else.
Yeah, I think Brian halved the contest with his opponent, which is all he can ask for.
The problem with the midfield, the centre clearances, was he halved the contests, but those that he did win, he rarely tapped to our guys. But the problem was the ball hits the ground and they've got, you know, Blitzarves and Dangerfield, who would have had 10 kilos on their opponents. You know, Parrish, Merritt, Caldwell, whatever. They just had those two beasts in there just running around, and it was very demoralising to see. We either got hopeless clearances, like we got a clearance, but it was like a high bomb kick or a pressure kick that went straight to Tom Stewart. We didn't have any of that flowing, free-flowing, fast pinpoint extractions from the clearances that we have had in the past. That was a real problem.
I think it's obvious around, you know, matchups. We've struggled with Richmond for, you know, a decade. Geelong is now the team, not even recently, with Hawkins and now Cameron with their midfield. We just struggle to match them across the ground, right?
Yep.
And, you know, we can you look at a Collingwood and others, we'll match teams on the run, but, yeah, Geelong, as you said, Jez, they just beat us across the lines because they're just bigger, more experienced.
And can I give the award?
Go
now. Yeah, I'm just going to give it to Hobbs because, you know, it shouldn't be that a 19-year-old is the leader or the shining light on a night like last night, but I think he was, and I think he deserves it. So I'll give it to him.
He's also very, very willing to put his body on the line. That's what I love about him.
Yeah.
Yeah, totally. He just was not fazed by the heat, and he just kept at it. So, yeah, he gets it.
Well, that was the easy bit, mate.
Yeah, look, it's so impossible to come up with a Henneman because it can't be a forward, right? Because the ball only went in there 28 times. 28, what was it, 28 to 65 inside 50?
Well, I'm surprised it was even 28.
Yeah. Well, it's funny you say that. You look at our bottom, just from a pure statistical perspective, and I recognise statistics are only part of the story, but from the bottom up, Peter Wright, 7 disposals.
Stringer wouldn't have had many.
Stringer, 8. Guelphy, 9. Langford, 9. Menzies, 10. Wiedemann, 10. And Hind, 10 as well, who obviously came on as a sub. And they're all the forwards, the forward line. I mean, they were more like to catch pneumonia than kick a bag of goals.
Yeah, and so I just don't think it can be one of them because the ball just wasn't down there. I don't think it can be a defender because they had no real chance. The ball was coming in so fast and so often, 65 inside 50s. And I, as I say, I think Lav and BZT did okay. It can't be Weed because of the little-known Hennemercy rule, which is that you can only cop it 3 times in a year. You can't get more than 3. So yeah, he's.
I was about to say, outside of that, it could be.
Yeah, I don't know.
But they're diving deep into the constitution of the Windsock to kind of pull that.
Yeah, I'd forgotten about the Hennemercy rule.
Yeah.
I must admit, like, he struggled. There's no question about it. And maybe expectations were really super high because of his early season form and this corresponding game at the start of the year, he kicked 5 goals. But the amount of anti-Wiedemann comments last night, you would think he was the sole reason we were. We lost by, what, how about 74 points or whatever it was. Like, he was not the sole reason at all. I do think one of the forwards deserves a special mention, Peter Wright. And it's, for me, it's a little bit like what I was saying about Phillips last week. Just his lack of contesting. Like, he's there, he's 2 metres, we kick to him, and even when he's one-on-one, the amount of times he just gets beaten. I wonder whether he's, if he's not a lead-up kind of forward, he really does struggle around the ground.
Maybe just on that solution, I was always, sorry, just to counteract you, Jez, is to say that I reckon Jake Stringer was putrid last night, even though he kicked a goal. The amount of times in the contest, yep, that was, for someone that's a big body, he was just beaten, and we needed him to stand up last night. We needed him in the middle to be that raging bull, but he was a wilting flower.
He got beaten in one-on-one contests so many times.
I think it's a bit unfair for him, though, because I as you all know, I'm a doctor of medicine and physiotherapist and orthopaedic surgeon, and I am sure he's carrying something, and he can still play, he can still run. He hasn't got the penetration in his kicking that he has had. I reckon he's probably got a groin or an adductor or something that means he hasn't got full power and movement. Because last week as well, when we really needed his presence in the centre square, they didn't play him there, and this week they didn't play him in there. They just sort of tried to hide him up the forward line, and he is a shadow of himself at the moment, and I reckon it's because he's carrying something.
Well, I think he needs to come and see you, mate. And we know your primary specialty is proctology. Need to get in and have a look.
Hey, Jez, having watched the replay, and I can't remember the exact contest, but there were 5 or 10 times one-on-one where we had guys that just did not even compete at all. Yeah. And you're watching it going, this is just, they looked like they just weren't even interested.
Yeah, I think a lot of our delivery was bad, but Geelong's a big team, they're an experienced team, but yeah, we were just bullied physically, whether it was in the contest, whether it was off the ball, whether it was in marking contest, whatever it was, they just smashed us. So little nudges here, little nudges there to get us out of position or, give us a shove and then take the mark, or just give us a shove and get us out of position. It just happened all night, everywhere.
Yeah.
It was just, I'm not sure what that is, whether it's just they're better at it than us or our heads were a bit off somehow, but physically we were not up for the fight for some reason.
It's okay. Snell got a mark at the top of the goal square. That was good. So.
That was at the time, was our only mark inside 50.
I think that's what they said. That was our first mark inside 50.
So I suggest you barely scratched the Henneman surface because you were excluding the forwards and defenders.
Yeah, I was about to say, I don't know if that's left me with many. It's impossible to. Yeah, there was no single weak link, for example. It's not like the teams were evenly poised and there was some weak link. But I'm going to give it to someone who pissed me off.
Hang on, Jez. There wasn't one single weak link. There was like multiple.
Yeah.
But what I'm saying is, like, it's not like one of those games where, you know, we were teetering on the borderline of winning, and there was some player who was a weak link, who would be the obvious award winner.
The herd mentality, man. You're safe in the herd.
Yeah.
You don't want to be on the edge of the herd with a bit of a sore hamstring. That's the only thing.
I'm going to give it to some. I'll throw a few names again. I thought Caldwell was ordinary, and that's probably a build-up of a few weeks for me wanting to suggest him. I'm a big fan, but I thought he was ordinary. I thought the one who pissed me off was Matt Guelfi, because I wrapped him up last week and said he was good, and I just thought he was just horrid last night. He was someone who was getting constantly pushed off the ball and pushed out of contests.
But he's a forward.
Yeah, I know. I've worked out. I haven't really left myself much. I've ruled out all the forwards and all the defenders and Wiedemann. And I've already given Brian and Hobbs a gold star and does. Yeah, so I didn't like Guelfi's game. I didn't like Stringer's game, but I'm giving him a pass because I just reckon he's injured. I think they should not have played him. I had my vision, as some people on this thing know. I had my vision on Saturday morning that Stringer would be a laid out. That didn't happen, but I think
Your vision on Saturday morning also included some other kind of.
Yeah, included an Essendon win.
A win.
And after the siren, win. Yeah. So my vision was off, but I give him a pass. Yeah, I unless I'm persuaded otherwise, I'm going to just randomly and probably unfairly give it to Guelph, because at the ground, at the game, he was one person whose efforts just pissed me off.
I'll tell you who pissed me off. The guy who's been spoken about as having offers on the table for a lot of money, Redmond. And I thought he started the rot at the start with some of his clangers. I don't know sometimes. I know he takes the game on and we love that about him. And I do love him at his best, but I thought he was awful at the start. And the kind of the jitters started. It's a bit like cricket when someone drops a catch and then another drops a catch and then everyone else starts dropping them. He started the fumbles early.
That's absolutely right. When I watched the replay, I was amazed at how good our first 2 minutes were. And then there was like...
Awesome 2 minutes.
Well, we absolutely toweled them the first 2 minutes. And then there was a couple of clangers, just a couple of, under pressure clangers. And it was just like the floodgates just opened.
Hey, Solution, you know some good things can happen inside 2 minutes. You know that.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Very good correspondent. Yeah. So you're giving it to Guelphy? Anyone got anyone else to throw in?
I think your point, though, was outside of that 2 minutes, very important 2 minutes, it just was putrid, right? Everything just went wrong. Confidence drops, and it was like game over. 7 goals to nothing, right? First quarter.
Yeah, and the head drops and the sort of visible signs that the guys were, not okay was so obvious. But yeah, they were just physically done because Geelong was just so good. Geelong had no weak links. They were just fantastic. They put their foot on our neck and they just kept going. And, they were a long way better than us.
And the irony, if you look at the stats, just player by player, Dangerfield got 15 touches. It wasn't it was not dominant Geelong names that we know. Mm-hmm. That, it was, we were just off, right?
All right. Anything else on the game? Or are we just going to have a bit of fun now with Douche and Deity?
Yeah.
Yep.
All right. Anyone got any douches or deities? I've got one douche, which could be a nomination for Douche of the Year. But what have you guys got?
I'll throw one out there for whoever is the director at Channel 7 for actually shooting the football. They've got no fucking idea.
It's the same as the guy that's doing the coverage of the cricket, where they can't even follow the fucking ball.
Yeah, we mentioned this last week. That was Windsock 2000's point. The obsession with close-ups at the expense of understanding the context of where the ball is in the game and what's actually happening in the play. I'd rather the VFL two cameras, to be honest. It's a lot easier to follow what's happening.
Yep.
Is that the issue, main issue, or is it?
I think so. They seem to have two views. You can see up the player's nostrils because they've gone that close in, or they've gone that far back that you can't actually see the ball. And they flick randomly between that and showing random people in the crowd while the game's actually being played.
Yeah. One thing I will say about the coverage, and I tweeted it, but I actually did it. I did turn the sound off at halftime. And I did it because the commentators were annoying me, but it did give me something slightly unexpected, but in hindsight predictable, gave me a level of detachment from the game that I actually needed, because as I said, my my eyes started to twitch. I was experiencing this sort of empathic pain, when you feel physical pain of someone else, and that kind of took that away. I'd recommend it for future thrashings, which could be next week.
We'll give it a shot.
Okay. Right. Hang on. So did you say you had a douche, which might be douche of the year?
Well, I do, but has anyone else got any douches or deities?
I'm just trying to think what's occurred in the last week within the global political landscape.
Well, while you think, I'll give mine, and I know Jez always prepares, so I'm sure he's got a couple. For me, it's Jared Whateley.
Yeah.
Absolute gold. Now, it's just for those who have been under a rock and haven't caught up with it. He was quoted. Anyone know what the quote was?
It was the comparison of Lionel Messi with Guyron Myers, right?
Yeah. And it was a ridiculous comment, which was kind of half believable, which speaks volumes about Jared Whateley, mind you. But it's a bit like anybody who's grown up in Australian male culture in particular, if you're called a nickname or you're called a name and you don't like it, the worst thing you could possibly do is say, don't call me that, because that will be your nickname forever from that point. And Jared Whateley's inability to show any kind of humour, and he's been blocking. I'm blocked. I think I've been blocked over this incident, because I haven't had any interactions with Jared Whateley apart from some smart comments as part of a thread. His inability to just laugh it off has turned this into a meme now, which there was more of it today. It is going to go on and grow legs, and like all great memes, will still exist in 5 years' time. And that's entirely your own making, Jared. And, you know, don't take yourself too seriously, mate, would be my advice. Was anyone going to bring that up?
That was a ripper.
That's a very good. That's a very obvious one. It's very good.
The original quote, for those who might be unfamiliar with this, the original quote was, Guyron Myers is to AFL what Leo Messi is to soccer. Messi may kick more goals, but Myers scans the field just as well, maybe even better than Messi does. Right? Now, yeah. So the hyperbole, it is exactly the sort of thing Jared would say, and it went bananas on the internet. It has been proved to be fake, false, not his quote. Get it? We get it. But you're right. Confronted with all of that, he just had to laugh it off and own it, didn't he?
It's like, as we all know, it's like, Jared, welcome to Twitter. That's how it works. Like,
and he was coming at people on Twitter saying, come on, take this down. Come on, remove it. Just a red rag to a bull.
Yeah.
Very, very funny. Then the memes, even today, were making me laugh.
I went to a school with a kid whose last name was Badcock. Yep. And on day one, when we're going through the roll and the teacher's asking everyone how they want their name pronounced, he said Badco, which might be right, but it meant that he then had an entire schooling where we made it clear what we preferred to call him.
I know a guy, used to work with a guy, and his surname, not the ex-Carlton footballer who I do know, David Glascott, this guy's surname was Glasscock, and he was at pains to say, no, I pronounce it Glassic.
Yeah.
I'm like, no, it's fucking Glasscock.
I got the saddest story of the lot, and this is true and very sad. It would never happen today, and totally non-PC. But we had a kid in our class, in my year level in primary school, who had cerebral palsy. And his parents, unfortunately, called him Edwin. Edwin. So he was Steady Eddie from, like, crap. Terrible. I feel so bad in hindsight. But parents had to have the foresight not to call him Edwin.
I thought you were going to say foreskin from
Ah, God. I can always rely on a bad joke from you, mate, to get me out of a PC hole.
Can we edit the last 5 minutes out of this?
5 minutes? No, absolutely not.
I know a gag about why there isn't a pregnant Barbie, but anyway.
less of that. As the English say, less of that.
Jesus.
No, he should have just laughed it off, and now it's a meme forever. So, do we agree? Did you have any more, Jez? Any other nominations?
No, I haven't done that this week. So no.
Any kind of any deity, any good shit that's gone down?
I reckon the I'm actually relatively excited in the Women's World Cup.
Yeah.
I actually watched the game on Friday, and it was not a bad game. And I think it's going to be a good tournament. So I'm going to big up the World Cup.
I agree. It might kind of be the little poke up the proverbial the AFL need around their complete lack of focus on management on women's footy. Because if you ask someone, when does the AFLW season start? I don't know. Later in the year.
Are we right in saying that it's supposed to start in a couple of months, and even the teams themselves
don't know?
Don't have any idea what the fixture is.
Correct. Yeah.
And these are not full professionals. So these are people with often jobs, students that need to kind of plan their life around. They need to play football around their life, not the other way around.
I think the season's starting the weekend of the bye before the finals, right? But that's all we know. But we haven't seen the draw. Oh, and jobs for the boys. You know, AFL HQ exec, who's now the head of the Australian Formula One Grand Prix committee. Wasn't he at Essendon years ago? You know, who's the guy that was in charge of the fixture?
Travis Auld.
Yeah, he's now the head of the Formula One Grand Prix committee.
Was there an extensive search by a...
Well, that's exactly right, mate. Absolutely correct. Exhaustive. Global.
Dear.
Yeah,
but we've already done inquiries of the...
That'll rank up there as the douche, right? It's just endless.
Did they make inquiries of Melbourne's leading sporting organisations, like the Thornbury Bowls Club?
Mate, I think we got an email and we went to our junk.
It's a good point. So you're a fan of, or you're a keen follower of the Essendon women's VFL team, Jez. And I know, correspondent, your daughters have played football. Is it fair to say that just in general, the AFL hasn't lived up to its promises around kind of investing in the women's game? That's what it appears to be from somebody that doesn't follow it that closely. Any comment? Or as a sports administrator at Thornbury Bowls Club, are you
I think your that general view is a very it's a pretty fair view. Well, Jez, you were there the other day with Snags and the Barbie, right?
Yeah, we had the president's function on the outer at Victoria Park. Me, my mate Tommy, and friend of the podcast, Katie Leo, one or two others. Shorey, Rob Shaw.
I believe, the great man Rob Shaw swung by for a snag.
Yeah, no, he wouldn't have a snag. They'd had some nice lunch that he didn't want to spoil with a Woolworths sausage and bread.
Can't think why not.
No, but it was that was good. And the Australian women, the Essendon women, did really well. They fought it out hard. They were playing Collingwood, who finished on top. So they were playing, you know, the real deal, and they only lost by 4 points and could easily have won it. It was a classic sort of bob of the head. But they live to fight another day in a prelim next week on Sunday against Port at Port. So that'll be fun. But no, I take a slot. I mean, my daughter plays footy. One of my boys umpires, and today he umpired two games of women's footy, girls' footy, under 15s, and then the youth girls. There's a lot of girls playing footy. There's a lot of girls with interest in footy. Something's going right, but it does seem odd that the peak of women's football is in such a state. I mean, there was that article during the week about crowd numbers, audience numbers, all being predicted to take a big hit this year and a big drop, and they're kind of flagging that the comp's going to be a step down from last year. I don't know why, but that's all disappointing. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's plenty of women still playing and having a lot of fun.
Plenty of money being spent by the AFL and other things. So, yeah, I do wonder about the priorities. Just one point I did want to make on the Women's World Cup that does worry me is I'm pretty sure the Australian team is playing at least its first two games on rugby fields that are currently in use. And if you watch if you watch the game at Marvel Stadium, it's a different type of surface that you need. Obviously, when the ball's rolling along the ground for pretty much 78% of the game, it needs to be at a level that's better quality than the other football codes. And, yeah, I do worry that the quality of the football will be impacted by the stadiums they're playing on. But anyway.
Yeah, it needs to be, like, the outfield needs to be similar to that of Edgbaston last week. You know?
When's cricket start, by the way?
Wednesday night. I tell you what, Dushan, we Australia pressure bunnies, we are under the pump big time.
Yeah, well, apparently we can't handle the fast bowlers because we know the English like to talk. We can't handle the new guy.
And can I just say, by the way, Dave Warner, like, seriously, he is telling us when he's going to retire. I'm going, no, mate, we'll tell you. And it should be before the next test.
What are you talking about? He's absolutely going to tell us when he retires. He's got every right to think that he can bat as long as he wants. Just look at the available evidence.
Yeah, I know. Anyway.
We are petering out, gents. So shall we just talk about next week's game and then...
You mean the mini elimination final?
Yeah. So do we just... Are we going to turn it around? We're playing Friday night. When did the Bulldogs play? Thursday, wasn't it?
They probably had a bye.
I think they played Thursday in Sydney.
They did, yeah.
You're making the point again that it's another week where the other team has at least 48 hours on us.
Yeah, exactly. Not that we necessarily raised a sweat Saturday night. It's probably the counter argument. Mm. But, you know, it's been pointed out earlier, we had a good VFL game today. Are there some players that can come in, some fresh legs?
Well, yeah, of course there are. But, you know, like the Bulldogs, you know, they I watched a bit of that game on Thursday. I'm not saying they're fraudulent, but you know, they've got some very talented footballers. But they... yeah, they probably. How on earth they didn't win that game, I don't know.
Hmm.
But yeah, we're going to struggle up again. You know, again, you know, Bonampelli, obviously, Ugal Hagen and others. They've got a good side, but I reckon, who knows, mate? We could come out, you know, recharged, re-energized. Are there some players who could come in? Yeah, like, you know, Cox was an emergency. Sardis is not far away, but you know, coming in for whom? I mean, what are we, you know, like, you know, we know that Brad Scott he's reluctant to make changes. And having said, you guys mentioned that Stringer's under a cloud, Ridley clearly could have been rested, right?
Well, let me ask you this, Architect. Does Phillips come in for Brian?
I still would bring him in. Because he had been pretty good for the prior 2 weeks from a ruck contest point. So, yeah, I would bring Phillips in, and I probably would rest Stringer because of just how – if he's – Jez, if you're right, if he's injured, just don't play him.
Maybe your premonition was just a week late, Jez.
Yeah, that's but that's been Scott's, you know, mantra, like not playing guys who are under a cloud yet. He's played Stringer.
And he's also played Shiel.
Yeah.
But Jez, what do you think? Any changes you'd make if you were the man in the hot seat?
I didn't see the VFL today, but our VFL team has won two games in a row, slightly unexpectedly, I think. So they're obviously playing well. There's obviously some good stuff happening there. This is an elimination final. I think we're not yet at the point, I think, where you'd play Brian ahead of Phillips just because you want to develop Brian. I think we've just got to still pick our best team every week. We are in that rough and tumble where one win kicks us up to, you know, fifth or sixth. The loss kicks us down to 10th. The wins are still important. Play the best team for the conditions and the team. And, I think, we're a chance. We're a chance against the Dogs. I've been underwhelmed when I've seen the Dogs, and I'm surprised that they and St Kilda are still in the eight. I've seen some really good footy from GWS, some really good footy from a few others who are just outside, dare I say, at Carlton. I'm not sold on the Dogs or the Saints yet, so I think we've got a chance.
Certainly not sold on the Saints.
No.
Hey, open question. What do we do with Wiedemann?
Do we try him just off halfback? Two weeks in a row, he's actually looked better down defence.
He either plays in the back line or he doesn't play.
Yeah, I agree.
The thing about him up forward is that he does take a big defender. He does create space for Peter Wright or whatever, but it ain't working. It ain't working. But he has looked more assured down back.
Yeah.
That's not saying much, more assured than he looks up forward, but he looks more assured. So that might not be a bad call.
Well, his specialty is he'll get to the marking contest and he goes for the ball and he doesn't mark it and brings the ball to ground, which in the back line's fine. That's great. So do it down there. But I reckon just being able to run at the ball and not have that pressure of kicking goals will be a mental holiday for him.
But, you know, Tim English, you know, I agree, we've got to bring back Phillips. We probably have to play, well, two ruckmen, because English is playing some good footy, right?
Very good footy, yeah.
And Phillips, as we know, he'll play a good game or two, but his tank will run out. So either, you know, I'm not saying, you know, Brian's athletic, then you run Wiedemann through the ruck, but, yeah, it's pretty hard.
A bit like this podcast, pretty hard going.
Very true.
Has this podcast brought back some of that pain solution? You sort of look like you've got a little, you're dealing with a bit of a headache there.
Yeah, a little bit. Just thinking of yes, last night. For all the shit I talk and tweet, I don't really take it too much to heart, but yesterday was really, really, I just wanted us to be competitive. No one was expecting us to win. I don't think anybody minded us losing. Just the lack of competitiveness still irks me. I was more cut by the Port game because we should have won that game. But yeah,
it was a very truck rutten era performance.
Oh yeah. Very good point. Very good point.
And probably maybe it was the first one for this year.
Yeah, 100%. A nice reminder, perhaps, of where we don't want to go and what we don't want to be. But anyway, what do you reckon? Who's going to win? Score. Architect, you start.
Ooh, all right. I don't know. I'm hoping that there is a bit of fight that after this week. I'm hoping that we can get up by 12 points.
12! Correspondent? Stop betting on greyhounds, mate. I can see.
No, sorry, mate. What you're doing. I'm just reading an article about Britt Eklund, who's turned 80, and she's just saying, When you count the number of affairs I've had, I've really only had a few. Anyway. No, I'm a bit the same. I think we'll win. And I'll say 10 points.
Was she a Bond girl, by the way, Britt Eklund? Oh, yeah.
She was, but this is more about her time with Peter Sellers and, he had a life, didn't he? Jesus. Anyway.
Yeah, I do remember there's a story, famous story about Sean Connery, apparently, where he was at some lunch and there's a group of people there and corporate kind of people. And then someone was asking him about his affairs, and you know he was quite a conservative guy, Sean Connery. And someone said, "Oh, did you sleep with any? Because he'd been married for decades. Did you sleep with any of the Bond girls?" And he just went white, got up, left the room, and everyone's saying to this guy, "Like, you fucking idiot, what are you doing? He's Sir Sean Connery. You don't ask him that question." And he came back and said, "Oh, sorry, Jen. Interjection. Yeah, I did. The best one was Britt Eklund, up the arse, 1968.
Oh, jeez.
And then he went on to tell all the stories.
So no, you're right. She was Bond girl Mary Goodnight in The Man with a Golden Gun.
Okay. I love those suggestive titles too.
Yes.
Octopussy.
She was also Michael Caine's girlfriend in Get Carter, which is a very good film.
Yes, it is. It is.
Not the Sylvester Stallone version of Get Carter, but the original version.
Oh my God! Yeah.
I didn't know we're doing a David and Margaret show tonight. But anyways.
No. Jez, did you give a score?
I didn't, but we will win by 3 goals.
I love all your optimism. Collective optimism. I think we lose by 20 points, and I think unfortunately we're going to miss the 8 by a couple of games. And we will reflect at the end of this year and say, you know what, there was a lot of important steps taken. So I still believe in the process, the journey we're on, and everything else. I just reckon it's not our year this year. All right. So song of the week, I actually recut it, by the way, the one I sent you, just so my vocal wasn't as patchy. It's about Ridley. It's about as lackluster as the performance, to be honest. But it's to the Commodores easy.
You're too harsh on yourself. It was good, really good. Love it. Big fan.
Same. I thought it was a decent effort, mate. Selling yourself short.
Yeah. So, it was okay, but anyway, I haven't listened to that, but I am on a little bit of a roll, so I'll take song suggestions. Jez did submit a song suggestion.
You've knocked back my two suggestions in a row.
Well, I haven't knocked them back, but what was the last one again?
The one that had no rhymes in it. I can't remember what it was, though.
Yeah, that's right, you just ruined the punchline.
Oh, it was KC and the Sunshine Band.
And the concept was?
Instead of
Give it up.
It was Cats Away instead of That's Away.
Yeah, Cats Away.
Uh-huh. That's right. It was all about playing down at Cadinia Park.
Yeah. And the chorus was great. And the verse was just four lines that completely didn't rhyme, which normally a song, like, that's how lyrics tend to work. Every second line tends to rhyme. But anyway.
So you take suggestions. You're taking suggestions.
Yes. Yeah. That's my point. So feel free. Oh, guys, feel free to record. I know, Architect, you play a bit of guitar. Feel free to give it a go, mate. Come up with something.
Hey, you think your singing's bad?
While we've got you here, though, Architect, how about Windsock 2000? Has he got the module to be able to come up with some pop classic for us?
It'd be some Dre beats on Windsock 2000.
I'll have to do a remote patch upgrade, Jez, and we'll see how we go.
Yeah, I don't like our chances. The Windsock 2000 actually talks out of tune, let alone sings. So, yeah. But anyway.
Hey, Solution, one of my daughters said she'll do backing vocals. Remember to from a few weeks ago. So.
Yeah. Well, she's welcome. Welcome. I'll send her the audio and she can just record her lyrics over the top if she likes.
Okay.
All right. Done. All right. Well, on that note, check out our spot.
Now, can we do like one of those back in the days, like Stars on 45, do some kind of, you know, We Are the World melody thing?
Did you not hear the live? Did you hear us do...
No, but you know, you and I both know it doesn't work well over this forum because of the noise cancelling, right? So if you got us all in the one room.
I think it would just amplify the shit, to be honest.
when we do the live pod from the sauna, we could just finish it with a song.
Live from the sauna.
Tell you what, before, it's funny, I'm glad you said that, by the way, because it reminds me that you'll recall we have spoken about going live and showing our faces if we hit.
Now you're saying this is like we do recall, but keep going.
Yeah, we did say at the start of the year we put the carrot out. If we get enough subscribers, we will reveal ourselves on a live pod. And then I put it up on iTunes and Spotify for the sole reason really to try and put people off the YouTube scent because we were getting precariously close to that level.
We fragment our audience.
That's right. I've fragmented it. I've decided to divide and conquer. But turns out we've broken through the 220 mark. So we're only 30 subscribers away from people being able to...
A full reveal.
Do a full reveal, which, yeah, you wouldn't wish on your worst enemy, would you?
I might have to unsubscribe if we get too close.
Yeah, I think if we all unsubscribe...
Well, that'll account for how many members of the podcast? About 8 of us. That'll account for 8. But we're not far away, so...
I'll get my cat and dog to unsubscribe.
Yeah, you might want to do that. Feel free to like and subscribe. Now, I'll try and do this once more. Does anyone got anything else to say? No? All right. Check out the sponsor, Something About Cake. Thanks to everyone that listened. Tune in to the forecast, Fiona's forecast, the end of the week, and I might do something in the middle of the week as well, whether it's a song or some snippet from something. But yeah, thanks to everyone that listened, and we'll see you next week.
Go Bombers.
Go Bombers.
I did money on Sunday and I couldn't stand the pain, so I went down to the rooms, but other than injury nothing can stop me. No, I just look so freaking smooth. Cause I'm Jordan Ridley.